Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text, as you have heard, is the epistle lesson from James chapter 2. And our theme this morning, in Christ Jesus, live without partiality. Please be seated. My dearest brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, it's wonderful being back in the pulpit. I'm now again doing the work of our Lord, and that brings your pastor great joy. Another thing that is also of a great joy is proclaiming to you not only the gospel, but also the law of God. Many don't like hearing the law, and then sometimes too many hear too much law. But the law today is that when we consider some individuals to be more worthy than others, we show a failure to believe in the gospel that was preached before the cross, that was preached at the cross. Dear friends, you'll hear this morning God telling you that faith must be before works, and that at the cross is where salvation was attained, was won for all people. In other words, the Savior who hung here, he lived without partiality, and he died without partiality. This partiality, which all of us show to some extent, bears proof of our struggle to believe that we are truly justified by faith and not by works. Yes, since we are all sinners, there are people that we prefer over other people. There are those who prefer to run with a certain flock of birds, if you will, and those other birds that live on the other side of the tracks will ignore them, or even worse, will oppress them, will destroy them. It's true that all of us have preferences. There's no doubt about that. Some of us like wild flavors in ice cream, while others of us just like plain old vanilla. No problem in that. These distinctions, though, are important in our lives. My dear friends, Scripture clearly tells us that men are men and not women, and that women are women and not men. We also know that adults are not children, although many adults act like children. And we also know that children are not to be adults, even though some children are forced to live as an adult. But distinctions as to worth before God have no place in the life of a Christian. The distinctions as to worth before God have no place in your life or in my life. And it is for this reason that James tells us this morning that in Christ we are to live without partiality. Because to live with partiality is to deny our faith. Sinful partiality considers some people to be more worthy of others. All you have to do, my friends, is look at world history and you see the awful truth in this. In the 1930s and 40s, it was the Jew who wasn't worthy. And therefore, there was a certain class of people in Germany who oppressed them and was determined to exterminate them. Today in our society, there are those who hate you because you're a Christian. And they are working each and every single second of the day to ensure that your life is miserable. And if they can, they will also exterminate you. This morning, the Apostle James is telling us of a situation in which a rich man comes into the assembly, and he is given special treatment because he wears a gold ring and he wears fancy clothes, and he's given a seat of honor. But the poor man who is dressed in shabby clothes, he is told to go sit in the corner, or he's told to sit at the feet of the preacher. A place of servitude, a place of menial servitude. We often make judgments like this. We call those value judgments. and we place our values onto other people. Such attitudes, as James tells us, are sinful. Why is it sinful? You'll see it here on your bulletin insert. It's verses 8 and 9. It's the breaking of the second table of the law. And when we break the second table of the law, we are placing ourselves above our neighbor. And essentially what we're doing, dear friends, is when we place ourselves above our neighbor, who is also a sinner, just like I am a sinner and you are a sinner, we are actually placing ourselves above our God. When the law is broken, as James tells us, even when we break one commandment, when you break one single commandment, you break all 10. So therefore no one can tell me, and neither can I tell you, that I've never broken a certain commandment, because we have all broken all 10. And we do this daily, and we do this much. Partiality by a Christian is doing one thing, dear one, but believing something else. It places contradictions into our lives, which again James tells us right there in verse 4, "Have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts?" We relish in the idea all too often of judging our neighbor, of saying that this person doesn't deserve, this person shouldn't be, this person deserves this or that. Aren't we placing ourselves above them? I have no right to do that. I am a sinner. You have no right to do that. You are a sinner. By the way, Paul writes for us and tells us, God does not show favoritism. So therefore, why are we to show favor over a particular person or a particular class of people? God's entire nature and His dealing with us in law and gospel completely excludes partiality. Aren't we Christians? And therefore, since we are Christians, Christ lives in us. Aren't we to live as Christ living in us? But when we exclude, when we forget about our neighbor, when we think that our neighbor doesn't need our help and therefore we'll ignore them, we are then sinning against our neighbor and we're sinning against our God. You see, these partialities, they send a mixed message, not only to the world, but it sends a mixed message to yourself, to your neighbor, to your pastor. And when we send mixed messages, dear ones, ultimately it will cause someone to stumble. And as a Christian, we are not to place a stumbling block before our brother or sister in Christ Jesus. Why? Because the gospel proclaims that salvation is for all people. For God sent His Son to die for the entire world, for all mankind. We're saved right here. It doesn't matter who the person is. It doesn't matter the color of their hair, the words that come out of their mouth, or what they even believe. Christ has still died for them. It is He who will judge. It is not for us to judge. We are not to be partial. We are to proclaim the gospel of our Lord and Jesus Christ so that all will hear and confess and be saved. After all, there is only one Lord and Savior, and you're not it. And neither am I. Jesus answered Thomas and said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." Jesus is speaking of Himself when He says me. He's not saying Jeff, and He's not saying your name. He's saying His name. Christ impartially took the sins of the whole world, the sins of every person who has lived, who is living, and who will live. And He put those sins onto His shoulders and He nailed them to His cross. Jesus is the Savior. Not you, not me, not anyone else. And He did this, dear ones, out of His great love. Not only for you, but for the poor man and for the rich man. by Christ being impartial and shedding his blood for the whole world, God forgives. He forgives you of your sin. He forgives you when you show partiality over one person and ignore the other. He forgives your sin when you'd rather run with this flock of birds but exterminate or oppress or forget about this flock of birds. You understand my meaning, right? There are those who are among us who we'd rather not deal with, and therefore we just ignore them. You see, I don't have that right. I have to deal with them. I am called to do that. It will happen this week. I will do it with great joy, for it gives me the chance to proclaim to them the gospel of our Lord Jesus. Even though they chose never to be here, I will still be with them, and I will proclaim the glory of Jesus and what he has done for his saint that he has taken home and for those who remain. God forgives, not on the basis of my worth or not on the basis of your worth, but on the basis of Jesus' work and his worth as the worthy Lamb of God. This he accomplished upon his cross. You and I know this. And this objective truth exists outside of ourselves. In other words, my dear ones, I'm saying to you that you cannot take credit for your salvation. And therefore, what gives you the right to take credit for your salvation and to oppress your neighbor, to forget about your neighbor, to think that your neighbor just doesn't exist? Together, we are all beggars before this cross. We come equally undeserving. You will come equally undeserving to this table this morning. That you and I will equally leave this table forgiven of all of our sins. You see, God will serve each and every one who comes here, and he will give to that person, man and woman, body and blood, for the forgiveness of their sins. God shows no favoritism. God loves each and every one of you, and in his great love for you, he proclaims to you the forgiveness, the total and complete forgiveness of all of your sins. The wonderful message of the gospel is just that. We are invited. We are invited before our God to confess our sins. And in that confession, he is faithful and just to forgive us. And he does forgive. And he does announce, "Go in peace, my dear child. Your sin is forgiven." All who believe these words have the very same forgiveness. It doesn't matter who the person is, where they are from, what they speak, or what they have done, or what they have left undone. For us to be partial with certain people and oppressive to others shows our faith, dear ones. It is true faith that produces works. We are saved by faith alone, that is true. But we are not saved by a faith that is alone. Our faith must be evident to all. And how is that faith evident to all? By what we say and by what we do. By that faith that we show, that is the faith and the work that is being worked in us and through us by our Lord and Savior. How can we say that we're a faithful Christian but never come to church? How can we say that we're a faithful Christian but ignore our neighbor? How can we say that we're a faithful Christian but never support or do anything that we're asked to do in the name of Christ? Christ in? That's a Christian. It happened there at the font. That's when Christ came into your life. But you live as Christ is out. It's not Christ out, it's Christ in. So being impartial shows others your faith. James invites us this morning, dear ones. He invites us to show our faith by what we do. And what we are to do is to proclaim the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's what a Christian does. A Christian is faithful all the time, just not on Sunday. All the time. And when our neighbor needs our help, we reach out and we supply that help. We don't supply help only to the rich man, but to the one who is destitute and who is in fear and who is in pain and who truly needs our prayers and our help, our assistance, be it financially or spiritually. Yes, being impartial shows our faith. That impartiality opens doors for us to share the message, the gospel message of an impartial gospel. A gospel that saves. A gospel that announces what Jesus has done. Not what I have done, but what Jesus has done for you. And that's the importance of this. It's what Jesus has done for you. It's not what I do, or it's not what you do. It's what He has done and continues to do for you. Thanks be to Jesus. So therefore we close with these words as we heard from the Old Testament. We are to stand firm. We are to keep the faith and continue to be good stewards and to be faithful children, to be faithful Christians who show no impartiality, who reach out to our neighbor, who work for our God and proclaim His gospel, who proclaim a saving gospel, that Jesus has come. That is Jesus who has found you. It is Jesus who sought you. It is Jesus who has died for your sins. It is Jesus who has saved you from certain death by His atoning death. And on the third day He rose so that you too may rise on the great last day as He will call you forth from your place of rest. And as He calls you forth from your place of rest, He will take you to be with Him forever and ever. That is His promise. God does not show favoritism. He knows you, dear ones. He knows your heart. Repent. Repent of your partiality. Fall to your knees and repent. And He will have mercy on you. And He will forgive you of all your sin. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.